their moha. So this constant vacillation tendency is the expression of or the definition of tamoguna, which we called mohanatmaka. This is the first topic, the definition. Then the second topic that we discussed was the bandhana prakaraha, how each guna binds a person, which we can easily infer. A sattvic mind has always a knowing tendency, learning tendency, therefore naturally it is addicted to any infrastructure which is conducive for learning. It always loves learning infrastructure, which means quietude, which means seclusion, which means silence, which means withdrawal, which means reduction of relationship. Because relationship requires extrovertedness. And therefore, a sattvic mind is attached to knowledge infrastructure, whereas a rajasic mind hates a knowledge infrastructure of quietude, withdrawal, etc. A rajasic mind craves for a karma infrastructure. It wants to do something or the other, and therefore it wants people, it wants gadgets, it wants to go out. That is, it wants an infrastructure in which karmendriyas can be active. And this is called a bondage because it is addicted to such a setup. And if such a setup is not available, that person is a fish out of water, is unhappy. And therefore, whether unhappiness is caused by silence or whether unhappiness is caused by noise, unhappiness is unhappiness. And Vedanta defines moksha as that state of mind in which there is no unhappiness in noise also, there is no unhappiness in silence also. It is one which is not bound by either noise or silence. Therefore, sattvam sukhe sanjayati, that is called sukha sangha or jnana sangha, is the bondage. And rajoguna binds through karma sangha, attachment to karma. And tamoguna binds how? Nidra sangha. And tamoguna mind is not sure about what infrastructure it wants. Enna venamne theriyala. Still groping in darkness, and also it doesn't want to decide. Decision making, the tamoguna mind doesn't want. It is attached to vagueness. It is attached to negligence. It is attached to carelessness. So this is pramada sangaha. Up to this, we saw in the last class. Now we have to go to the next topic, verse number 10. Rajas tamashchabhibhuya. Sattvam bhavati bharata. Rajas sattvam tamashchaiva.
Vandam Shaiva.
Tamasattvam Rajastatha.
Tamasattvam Rajastatha.
So the third topic that Krishna is going to deal with is the lingam or the indicatory mark to know whether one is sattvic, rajasic or tamasic. But before entering into the third topic, Krishna is taking a small diversion. So the tenth verse is diversion verse. But of course it is a deliberate diversion, because Krishna considers this topic, this diversion topic, important. And what does Krishna want to say here? He says, every thing and being is made up of three gunas. Because everything and being is born of prakriti, from an inert object to the most intelligent human being, every blessed thing in the creation is a product of prakriti, and therefore everyone has got all the three gunas. But there is only one difference, and that difference is, even though everything is made up of three gunas, the proportion is not uniform. The proportion was uniform before the creation. During pralaya avastha, the three gunas were in equilibrium. In Sankhya philosophy, they call it gunanam samyavastha pralaya. But once the creation has started, there is no more equilibrium. There is vaishamya avastha. Vaishamya means what? In equilibrium. And therefore, in the case of an inert object, there also three gunas are there, but tamo guna will be the most dominant one in an inert object, and that is why the object doesn't have a learning tendency. You don't find a wall interested in Vedanta class. Why Vedanta class? Any class. Does it mean wall doesn't have sattva guna? The wall also has got that, but the tamo guna is dominant, therefore it doesn't have the learning capacity, nor has the wall a doing capacity. Thank God, if the wall wants to do some action, for the evening walking in and the pakam poram and no problem. It doesn't do that, it has got inertia. By inertia we mean neither knowing capacity nor doing capacity, because tamo guna is dominant. And once you come to the plant kingdom, it has got some amount of sattva and rajas. Even though a plant is almost like an inert object only, but the plant has got a dash more of sattva and rajas. It has got some sentiency to feel the environment which the inert object doesn't have. But it doesn't have extraordinary sattva guna to learn. Therefore, you don't have schools and colleges for plants. It doesn't have that capacity. And similarly, the activities also, in the case of a plant, is limited. The plant has a limited activity of growing, but you won't see a plant going for a walk. Thank God. இல்லைன்னா நீங்க டிரைவ் பண்ற சமயத்துல ஓரத்துல இருக்கிற ட்ரீ நடுப்புல வந்துடும். So it has got more sattva and rajas than an inert object, but it has got only a limited. And when you come to animals, you find sattva and rajas are still more dominant. Their capacity to learn and understand is more than the plants. And also they are not sthavaras. Sthavara means what? Not a stationary living being, but the animals are moving living being. That means Rajoguna is still more higher grade. And once you come to the human beings, Sattva and Rajas are still more dominant. And therefore human beings have got schools and colleges and books, and the knowledge goes on increasing, going up to Brahma Jnana. Similarly, the number of activities the human being undertakes is also innumerable many. So thus we find a gradual change in the proportion of the three gunas. And then within the human beings themselves, Krishna points out that all the human beings do not have the same proportion of gunas. Among the human beings themselves, some of them have got more sattva, some of them have got more rajas, some of them have got more tamas, and therefore their swabhavas, their character vary. And therefore, a sattvic person is defined as one who has got the predominance of sattva. It does not mean he doesn't have rajas and tamas. It only means sattva is dominant. And similarly, in rajasic person, rajas is dominant, and in a tamasic person, tamas is dominant. And the tamas can be so damn dominant that some people can be closer to animals, and some people can be closer to plants, and some people can be closer to a wall. Chitralojyo, kalla madhuri ukkandirikke, choodu chorana illaya kakralojyo. All these are possible even among human beings. And therefore, Krishna points out that sattvam bhavati. In a sattvic person, we have to supply that. In a sattvic person, sattva guna is present. How? Abhibhuya, overpowering or dominating rajaha tamaha cha, overpowering rajoguna and tamoguna. Sattva is dominant in a sattvic person. He Bharata, he Arjuna. Then rajaha bhavati. Bhavati, you have to supply. Rajoguna is present in a rajasic person. In a rajasic person also we have to supply. So rajoguna is present in a rajasic person. How? Sattvam tamaha cha abhibhuya. Abhibhuya nama add panikanam. Overpowering sattva guna and tamo guna. Rajas is dominant in rajasic people. And tamaha bhavati, in a tamasic person, tamoguna is present. How? Sattvam rajaha cha abhibhuya. Abhibhuya nama chetikanam, overpowering sattva guna and rajoguna. Tamas is dominant in tamasic people. Then comes a very, very important question. If a person is sattvic, rajasic or tamasic, is it a fixed character or is it possible for us to change the character of a person? Is it possible for a person to change the proportion of the guna? If we cannot change the character of a person, we are doomed, we are helpless. So our future is already decided in Arthamayadam. But fortunately, the sisters point out the swabhava of a person can be transformed. The rate of transformation will differ from individual to individual, and the amount of transformation also will differ from individual to individual. But transformation is possible. In fact, all the spiritual sadhanas are meant to change the proportion only, because every sadhana requires a particular guna as a dominant guna. And according to Shastra, generally most of the people are born with tamoguna predominant only, because as babies, what were we doing? Only two things. Sulugenaja undal orangana. Orangyal undana. As babies, we were sleeping for 10 hours, 15 hours, 18 hours. And the baby wakes up only for one purpose, for feeding. And after feeding is over, again it goes to sleep. Therefore, generally, we are all janmana tamah pradhana only. And therefore, Shastra prescribes the initial sadhana to convert from tamoguna pradhana person to rajoguna pradhana person. The scriptures want us to be active in life. And that is why Veda begins not with jnana kandam, Veda begins with what? Karma kandam. Your life has to start with karma or activity. And this karma kanda also they divided into two, because the rajoguna itself is of two types. One rajoguna is a rajoguna which is backed by tamoguna. That is rajoguna dominant 70% which is gulan, and the next one is tamoguna. 20% vachungalam, and the last one is sattvaguna 10%. So in one type of rajoguna, it is backed by tamoguna, and such a rajoguna will fold a person into selfish activities for the fulfillment of personal desires. And the Veda says, let your life start with selfish activities. You might have, why might have, you all have any number of personal desires. And even if you don't have, Karmakanda itself gives advertisement for various types of desires. Because the aim of karma kanda is what? Eppudiyo ezhundru get up. Kondu maada maadhiri paduthundru irukku. therefore the Veda tempts a person to fulfill the worldly desires of arthakama, earn money, buy house, buy a house and have TV, computer, car, all of them Veda encourages, and we don't have time for any service to the society. Veda says, doesn't matter, serve yourself. This is called selfishly active type of person, which I discussed in Chaturvarnyam context. I don't know whether you remember. And once a person has been selfishly active, Veda says, gradually change the character of activity. Previously it was RTS, RTS nanardam, rajoguna top, tamoguna middle, sattvaguna bottom. And the composition, eppidu maathanam, rajoguna top, appadiye irukkattam. Then instead of tamoguna in the second position, let the sattvaguna be in the second position and tamoguna be the least. So when a person converts himself from RTS to RST, a person is active because of rajoguna, but the activity is selfless activity. Even though there is selfish activity, it is limited. More and more activities are beneficial to more number of people. So, sakama karma to nishkama karma. And once a person has gone through these three stages, thereafter, Veda says, if this rajoguna is predominant and you are extrovert and active, you can never find time for jnana yoga. And therefore, let the karma continue up to a particular stage when the mind has become mature. And a time should come when your rajasic tendency should be converted into sattva. That is ippode pandrene solvar. We have to go out and be active, because what karma can give, upasana can never give. What upasana gives, karma can never give. And therefore, karma yoga is also must, upasana is also must. Upasana will convert a person from RST to RST lende enna varum SRT. SRT na enna? Sattva guna pradhanaha. And the rajoguna is in the middle position. Illana class ye varamaata adukku konjam rajoguna vanam adya aamidi inge varum kuda engaathukku varum kuda. No, you have to come and alavuk rajoguna vanam. So therefore he will have sufficient rajoguna to back sattva, and of course tamoguna is required. Illana thoongame ukkandirpa ellarku problem. Tamoguna is also required. And therefore, inactivity to selfish activity to selfless activity to inquiry. This is our gradual transformation. Inactivity to selfish activity to selfless activity to inquiry is our journey. And in fact, if you take the four ashramas, Brahmacharya ashrama,